Welcome to the interview series hosted by IQ and myself, Arisa Kishigami, as the navigator. Today we have with us two guests, Ms. Inga Kawa, Executive Director of the Access to Nutrition Initiative, as well as Ms. Katie Gordon, Advisor to the Access to Nutrition Initiative, commonly known as ATNI. Welcome to you both. Inga, may I first start with you to explain a little bit about Access to Nutrition Initiative, as well as the issue that we are going to cover today.
Hello, Arisa. Thank you for having us here today. The journey of the Access to Nutrition Initiative, which was originally incubated by the Global Alliance of Improved Nutrition, officially started in 2013. At that time, ATNI was created as an independent nonprofit organization hosted by the Access to Nutrition Foundation. Our main goal at ATNI is to address global nutrition challenges. ATNI's vision is a world where no one goes to bed hungry. Everyone eats a healthy, affordable diet that has all the nutrients needed to grow and develop fully. And deaths and illnesses from diets low in vitamins and minerals are history. More specifically, ATNI aims to drive private sector performance on healthy, affordable diets, to track the food industry efforts to tackle malnutrition in all its forms. We develop private sector accountability tools, which are based on our own ATNI research. ATNI's Global Index, which is published every other year, highlights nutrition, relevant commitments, performance, and disclosure by the largest food and beverage manufacturers globally. On top of a variety of research projects, ATNI also engages with institutional investors, which are a key stakeholder group for our organization, since institutional investors further incentivize food and beverage companies to take action on nutrition.
Thank you, Inga, for that overview. I would like to go into further detail about ATNI's initiatives later on. But to begin with, I'd like to clarify further the issue of malnutrition. Katie, I think when we think about malnutrition, some people may think about malnutritioned or malnourished children in poverty-stricken or conflict zone areas. Is that the right image to have? Or is it a wider issue than that? And what is the business relevance?
Malnutrition is an extremely complex issue. While it's true that conflict is one of the leading causes of malnutrition, the condition affects most countries in the world. According to the World Bank, malnutrition is one of the world's most serious but least addressed challenges. Three forms of malnutrition: overweight and obesity, undernutrition, and micronutrient deficiencies are altogether known as the triple burden of malnutrition. And all countries suffer one or more forms, and some all three. Additionally, poor diets now generate more disease worldwide than physical inactivity, alcohol, and smoking combined. These societal burdens have a significant economic cost. High levels of diet-related disease impair countries' economic growth, take up substantial proportions of their healthcare budgets, and reduce productivity among workers across all sectors, as outlined in a 2020 Chatham House report. The World Bank estimates that the economic cost of undernutrition, in terms of lost national productivity and economic growth, range from 2 to 3% of GDP in some countries and up to 11% of GDP in Africa and Asia each year. More developed countries are also affected by malnutrition. The OECD predicts a 3.3% average reduction in GDP between 2020 and 2050 due to lower employment and reduced employee productivity caused by overweight. And this includes Japan, which is witnessing rising rates of obesity, as recently reported by the FAO. Governments concerned with this economic burden that they are facing are starting to act to regulate and legislate the food industry, forcing the food companies to improve the healthiness of their packaged food products and tackle malnutrition. As stricter regulations are rolled out, for instance, with regards to food labeling and marketing, food manufacturers are forced to adapt by means of product reformulation, altering their marketing practices, and much more.
Thank you, Katie, for explaining not only just the different issues under malnutrition, but also the relevance to Japan. And perhaps I could just add on to that and say, I imagine that given the presence Japanese companies have in Asian countries through their employees and supply chain, that they could be impacted by the loss of productivity created through malnutrition issues. Which leads me to the next question. How does this impact the investors?
Well, firstly, it's really important to understand the scale of the packaged food sector. In 2019, Euromonitor found that total worldwide retail sales of packaged food and non-alcoholic beverages was approximately $3 trillion. By packaged food, I mean virtually all foods that are not mere agricultural commodities. Non-alcoholic beverages include energy drinks, soft drinks, hot drinks, and more. So this revenue is exposed to both investment risks and opportunities that arise from nutrition. On the one hand, malnutrition represents a clear and material risk to the investors with holdings in food and beverage companies. But on the other hand, the growing consumer interest in healthy diets is an opportunity for growth. So more detail on these investment risks. They include government regulatory action to accelerate the transition to healthier diets. Evidence shows that diets are primarily shaped by food environments, not by individual choices or lack of willpower. In other words, the problem is systemic, which requires alterations to how food is formulated, labeled, marketed, priced, and distributed, as recently outlined in the Lancet series on the double burden of malnutrition. For example, government reformulation targets force companies to improve the healthiness of their products. The aim is to reduce salt, sugars, and fats while maintaining good texture and taste and boosting levels of fruits, vegetables, and whole grains. Marketing restrictions and marketing guardrails are being introduced to protect children from unhealthy products. Globally, regulation of the food industry is increasing. Additionally, however, fiscal measures such as sugar taxes are an increasing risk to investment returns as governments try to claw back the state healthcare costs. There are now more sugar taxes than carbon taxes globally. So these combined regulatory and fiscal measures pose a significant risk to returns and investments in the food sector. And companies that are addressing them and embedding healthy nutrition strategies are likely to continue to have access to capital and ultimately be the winners. But it's not all doom and gloom. From an investment opportunity perspective, consumer demand for healthier food is increasing, and most companies are committing capex to create healthier products in a bid to capitalize on the predicted 6% compound annual growth rate opportunity predicted between 2020 and 2024. As ever, Investors must work out who the winners and who the losers are, and they must back the winners.
Thank you, Katie. I think that's a really powerful message that individual choice and willpower alone cannot change the situation around malnutrition, and that it can only be addressed by systemic change. But it was also interesting that individual choice is making a change, especially around the business opportunities and investment opportunities. Now, going back to ATNI, Inga, can I ask you how ATNI is helping to support investors to create that systemic change?
As I mentioned earlier, ATNI's goal is to tackle global nutrition challenges. Every action ATNI is taking is intended to encourage businesses to do more to achieve good health through improved diets and nutrition. So we engage with companies and other stakeholders to drive positive change. By tracking companies' progress over time and by engaging directly with companies, ATNI has seen companies adopting new measures to tackle malnutrition. With our global indexes and country-specific accountability tools, we assess food companies, manufacturers, retailers, and more recently, also small and medium-sized enterprises on 7 areas of action: governance, products, accessibility and affordability, responsible marketing, supporting healthy lifestyle for employees, food labeling, and stakeholder engagement. We also monitor compliance of baby food manufacturers with the International Code of Marketing of Breast Milk Substitutes. By assessing commitments, performance, and disclosure of company actions across these 7 categories, ATNI creates rankings and indices of different sectors in the food industry. And we also share best practices of the private sector with all relevant nutrition stakeholders. In doing so, ATNI also supports institutional investors in their analysis of the food sector, and we assist investors in their engagement with food manufacturers and retailers. And this is encouraging companies, since these investors are both shareholders and providers of credit, to address nutrition-related challenges. To this end, ATNI has supported the creation of investor expectations on nutrition, diet, and health, which is a framework of action to assist investors and other stakeholders in their engagement with companies.
Thank you, Inga. Katie, could you explain in further detail specific action taken by investors using the framework of ATNI?
Yes, of course. ATNI organises collaborative investor engagement around the publication of its global and US indices. And this engagement is available to all ATNI investor signatories. And these are investors who have pledged their support to the investor expectations on nutrition, diets, and health. In 2018 and to 2019, 31 of the investors representing 4 trillion of assets under management joined the engagement, which resulted in 29 statements made to investors by 14 companies. Additionally, 32 investors publicly acknowledge using ATNI data for engagement and analysis. And several investors amongst the signatories have reported on their usage of ATNI data and resources in their engagement reports, mostly focusing on engagement with companies on the risks linked to sugar specifically. Amongst these are Robeco, Candrium, Edentree, and Schroeder's, who indicate that ATNI is a very useful resource for both qualitative and quantitative data on company performance. Let me give you another example of how ATNI's engagement phase can be useful to investors. Achmea Investment Management has highlighted that the size of the ATNI investor group helps them to increase their leverage within engaging with companies such as Unilever and ConAgra, and that the possibility to discuss with ATNI's research analysts allowed ACMEA to take the engagement on nutrition to a deeper level. So investors recognize that ATNI provides not only a sizable group of supporting investors, but also valuable access to nutrition data, analysis, and experts.
Thank you, Katie. That's interesting to know. They can not just access the information, but it helps them to leverage and be heard by the individual companies as well as the industry. Now, for the companies that are in the audience today, Inga, could you perhaps share an example of a company that is acknowledged for its progress made on the issue of nutrition?
And since 2016, several companies have stepped up efforts to encourage better diets, and an increasing number of companies now engages with ATNI, which enables us for a more comprehensive assessment as compared to the early index in 2013. To provide you with a rough estimate of overall improvement in the sector, the average global index score improved from 2.5 out of 10 in 2016 to 3.3 in 2018. The 2018 ranking is led by Nestlé with a score of 6.8. It delivered above average performance in all and improvement in most of the seven categories on the index. For instance, the company has a global board-approved nutrition strategy, which includes a comprehensive set of 15 nutrition-related targets, which have been updated in 2016 and are now directly linked to the Sustainable Development Goals. Additionally, since the last index, Nestlé has updated its policy on marketing to children, which now sets an industry-leading audience threshold of 25% for children aged 2 to 12 years. Also, Nestlé remains one of the few companies that conduct an independent marketing audit, in addition to participating in industry associations audits that review the company's performance on compliance with its policy on marketing to children. This is definitely a positive performance.
Thank you, Inga. I think Nestlé is obviously a large multinational company. And my understanding is that the ATNI Global Index covers the just under largest 30 companies, including three Japanese companies. So is the issue around nutrition just relevant for those large companies, or is it relevant for smaller companies? And if it is relevant, then what are the first steps a company can take to address these issues?
Yeah, that's a very important question, because nutrition is relevant for all companies. We do understand, though, that smaller companies might have different capacities than the larger food manufacturers globally. However, all players along the food supply chain, from manufacturers to retailers, from multinational corporations to small and medium-sized enterprises, can play a role, whether big or small, in tackling nutrition challenges. The first step any company should take to tackle malnutrition issues is to embed nutrition in the commercial strategy of a company, and also to develop or adopt an internationally recognized nutrient profiling system. And it is also important to increase the transparency by disclosing all the actions that a company is taking on nutrition.
Thank you. In my final question, I'd like to ask both Inga and Katie specifically about Japan. I mentioned earlier that there are three companies currently in the global index list. But more generally, what are the expectations towards Japanese companies? And perhaps Katie can cover how can Japanese investors and lenders support such progress by Japanese companies?
Yeah, thank you. Well, the Japanese companies in ATNI indexes, namely Ajinomoto, Meiji and Suntory, have made a start on nutrition. Yet there are still more to go in addressing nutrition issues, as is with all the companies on our index. The first recommendation would be to fully engage with ATNI, which Suntory currently does not do yet. And this engagement allows for more comprehensive assessment. As you can see on the slide, Suntory and Meiji companies scored relatively low across the 77 categories of the corporate profile. And ATNI encouraged these companies to improve in all areas. Of the three Japanese companies assessed in the Global Index 2018, Ajinomoto stands out for its progress. Despite a relatively low index ranking, Ajinomoto committed to develop a nutrient profiling system to assess the healthiness of its products, which is a major step forward. And this action was partly the result of engagement with the company by a group of 22 investors among ATNI's investor signatories. We look forward to further progress by Ajinomoto, and we hope that other Japanese companies will follow in their footsteps and disclose more information on their nutrition commitments and policies across all the 7 categories of action mentioned earlier. Katie, would you like to cover the expectations for investors?
Of course. Japanese investors can help bring about significant positive change within the private sector by engaging with Japanese as well as other companies globally to scale up their nutrition efforts. 2021, which lies in the middle of the United Nations Decade of Action on Nutrition, has been declared as the Nutrition Year of Action. And Japan is in a perfect position to take action on nutrition this year, as it is hosting the Nutrition for Growth Summit in December. This global event will bring all nutrition stakeholders together and will be a unique opportunity for all actors involved to make new commitments. Japanese investors therefore have the opportunity to make affordable, healthy diets a priority for companies. They also have the opportunity to significantly influence global frameworks and processes, such as the Tokyo N4G Summit and the United Nations Food Systems Summit being held in September. This has been done by institutional investors for climate change over the past 15 years, and this year we'll see the start of it being done by institutional investors for nutrition.
Thank you. I can see that the momentum is only going to grow as the Nutrition for Growth Summit and the other conferences take part, not just for Japan, but for the developments globally. I would like to thank you both again, Inga and Katie, for your time today and for sharing with us perhaps how to address the misconceptions around the concept and issue of malnutrition, as well as sharing with us specific steps that companies as well as investors can take. Thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.